World Podcast. I'm AJ. Joerg is there. I'm going to be in a different place soon, in different clothes, but he'll be in the same place, in the same t-shirt.
Exactly. Always.
Yes. He never changes his clothes.
I always go around the SceneWorld. I have like 14 of those. SceneWorld is my life.
Actually, he's just really pale and that's a tattoo on his chest.
Oh. Last time I looked? yeah. So anyway, I hope you enjoyed our Jay Maynard live podcast and our Gamescom special podcast.
Yes.
Well,
I did.
And AJ actually got into love with cosplaying.
Totally, yeah. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Yeah, the next just time...
Just wait till what I dress up for at a video game con in
a Rotten Tomato.
A Rotten Tomato?
No.
I have to dress up in some way that will... Because I've got to wear... I'll be wearing the SceneWorld t-shirt, so I have to incorporate that in some way. In my costume. So.
You could put the stamp on it.
Yes, yes. I don't know what I'm gonna do with the stamp. What I've got for our viewers here, I have a packet of materials to bring with me to a video game con, which is occurring in Whippany, New Jersey, on some date in August, in September rather.
The 19th or something?
I believe it is the 19th. Yes, September 19th, Parsippany, New Jersey. I said Whippany. I'm totally wrong. Parsippany. It's 33 Baldwin Road. And I have a packet of things to bring with me, including a SceneWorld t-shirt and business cards, which I will be handing out to people that may want them. And I'll even sign one if people might want me to do that. I don't know why they would. And I have a stamp. A rubber hand stamp, or just a rubber stamp, rather, for stamping things. And I have no idea what I'm going to do with that.
That is because Vistaprint included it because I was such a nice customer
since
so many years. So.
Right, but I have this thing, so it's I'll be bringing it with me, and I guess I'll stamp something with it. I just don't know what.
Our fans.
Yeah, yeah. If you want to be stamped by me, come to a video game con on September 19th, and I will stamp you with a stamp.
I have been stamped.
Oh. Yeah, yeah. I don't know what else to say. Yeah, I'll stamp you.
That's our SeaWorld viral stamp.
With a stamp and not my size 12 feet. Huh.
So, what we got in the news? Well, as you mentioned, the Video Game Con, Walter Day, famous scorekeeper and founder of Twin Galaxies, actually made a deal with the current founder, the current owner of Twin Galaxies, that allows him to continue doing his trading cards. So he has opened a new website, which is pretty cool, and this is TheWalterDayCollection.com, and there you can find news about where to get his cards from and stuff.
Excellent, excellent. And you are going to be on a card, are you?
Yes, he sent me a message on Sunday that he wants my postal address because he included SceneWorld in his collections because he said we are doing a very good job with the magazine and the podcast and the video interviews and so on, and we are, well, people will remember the history of what caused our modern world, because we are talking to those inventors and famous people. So he said we should be on a card, and He wanted my face because I'm the main founder of SceneWorld for some reason. I had this crazy idea when I was a teenager, and I found many people, to my surprise, who shared my vision and wanted to help me. And Chase, one of them. Yeah.
I don't have a card though, but Maybe someday.
Well, you are the podcast guy. So.
Yeah.
Yes.
I'm the American. Now we've got a couple more Americans.
And other news is that Gearbox, who released Duke Nukem Forever, and who bought the brand from Three Realms a while ago, actually settled with the current 3D Realms. And Frederick Schreiber, the vice president of 3D Realms, announced...
Who we spoke to.
Who we spoke to.
Ago.
Yeah. Next to Mike Nielsen, who was CEO. And Frederick Schreiber announced that they settled and that the Duke Nukem franchise belongs to Gearbox. And they are focusing on other IPs and on Bombshell.
Right, which is a, which is what they were working on. They were going ahead with Bombshell, and we spoke to them. We got to see some exclusive pictures and stuff that we unfortunately couldn't share with everybody because it wasn't ready for prime time yet. But now we're getting closer, and so this is good news that they'll be able to move ahead with this and continue the development of it. And you will be speaking. Well, actually, both of us, because there will be a Twitch show coming up, a live show. Joerg has been doing the series for the museum. Tell us about this.
The Film Institute of Frankfurt, the Film Museum of Frankfurt, for film and games interactions, mm-hmm. And this exhibit is about how games influenced films and how films influenced games, and mm-hmm. so and it is themed like Tron. This is why we spoke to the Tron guy the last time. And so yes, since June I'm actually interviewing people that came from the video game industry or the creative demo scene industry or the film movie industry to help that exhibit to be successful and showing some background.
And this will be going on through January, last Wednesday of every month. And the next one, we'll be talking. I'll be taking part in the next one as well. I'll be there as a kind of just background thing. It's not going to be a podcast like this. It's going to be the regular night at the museum thing that Joerg has been doing.
Yeah.
And but we'll be he'll be talking to
3D Realms. I don't know exactly to whom yet, because I still have to talk to Fred, because he just returned from PAX.
Yeah.
And hopefully we'll see some more of Bombshell, because they had playable demos at PAX and TwitchCon. So they have something actually to show now. That's pretty interesting.
And because we talked to them on the podcast, Joerg asked me if I wanted to take part in the live Twitch show with them, and I said, yeah, absolutely. I'll be happy to sit there and throw in my cent and a half occasionally.
Yeah. Or more than that, yeah.
Possibly, potentially.
Yeah. And Sven Fössing, our Retro Hunt's back, and mm-hmm. he announced that from now on, all his episodes will be in English as well. So
really?
As you know, the last special he did was Ghostbusters, and he did it especially for SceneWorld because I interviewed him in English.
That's right.
2 years ago, and I asked him if he could do a show in English, and he said, yeah, why not? And it was so successful that he got so many viewers on that English episode that he decided to make English from now on as
cool.
well. So this special he had now was from Gamescom. He spoke to Ron Gilbert, who invented the SCUMM interface of Adventures. Graphic adventures, you know, like take, open, kick, hit. No, not kick and hit, but you get
the
idea.
The user interface that was from Monkey Island and Day of the Tentacle and
Maniac Mansion.
That
was the first one using
the Kraken and the Mindbenders and many, many, many more.
Yeah, that weren't from Lucasfilm, LucasArts. Many, many more too.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, and he spoke to him, and so yes, that's a special. So we actually had some influence here. We we irked Sven to go on with English right now. So
cool, cool. And yeah. And we love Sven. He's been on the podcast as a guest and as a special co-host.
Yeah. He is looking at the questions in the chat.
So, and we'd love to have him on again. He, you know, maybe sure. He could do some fill-in. Maybe if I have to do something, you guys can work together. If you have to do something, he can take over for that. Or I don't know. We'll figure it out. It's yeah. fun. It's fun to have the three of us.
And it's just fun. I mean, imagine three from 3D Realms, three of us. That's like six people. Yeah. Fortunately, we have this tacky guy, Sebastian Kreiner, who actually does this live stream thing for a living, so he did a very good job at the Tron thing, yes. You know, flipping around all the cameras and the scenery and stuff. Was really professional, like on television.
Yes. Well, it kind of was on television, because this is where television is going.
Yeah.
So.
We spoke to Norbert Varga.
Yes.
In Serbia.
Yes.
So a Serbian development studio for video games. He is CEO and producer and designer Digital Error Limited.
And chief underwater expert.
Yeah.
So he is waiting in the wings to talk to us. So let's go and have a rousing conversation with him.
So hello, Norbert.
Hello, guys.
Welcome to the podcast.
Great.
Thank you. It's good to be here.
Thanks. Yeah. It's quite interesting because I've never heard before of this Kickstarter. I just was notified that a friend, you were staff pick on Kickstarter, actually.
Yes, we were.
And I remember the roots of that game. That was actually BlueByte Software who released the first version in Germany in 1996, so
yes, Archimedean 9 years ago. Dynasty.
Exactly. Yes. And now we are talking to you.
Serbia.
Serbia. Interesting that it moved from Germany to Serbia. Anyway, it's a pretty interesting move.
We don't see too many. Well, I mean, for all I know, there could be, but the British have, you know, kind of somewhat popular publishing houses for games going back a long way, and you know, the U.S. had game, you know, big companies, EA and all that stuff that has gone back for a long time, mm-hmm. But that area, Serbia now, as you were saying, but I don't know too much of the history of how all that stuff worked over there. You know, I come from like the demo scene, which there was a lot of Europe, a lot of America in that, you know, with the old retro computers and stuff. And,
yes.
And I, you know, you never hear too much about how that worked in that, you know, in that part of the world. And it's of interest to me.
There's a well-known demo scene person, Branimir Karadzic or something like that. He is actually from our town, I think.
Oh.
So I think that's how it's called. He was a well-known demo scene person. Maybe you've heard of him. But actually, you're right. We don't really have too much video game development here. We have a hidden object puzzle adventure is the HOPA thing, the hidden object thing. Mm-hmm. That's a lot. There's a large studio here called Apex. Maybe you've heard of them, but
I have actually.
But beyond them, there's the Metamorph guys who did some stuff, and then the Madhead guys. I think that's ex Metamorph. I'm not very up to date about all the changes, but yeah, you're right. Most of the actual 3D, so to say, 3D video game development that is not the hidden object is pretty small. There's a lot of small mobile indies, I think, but it's quite new in the region. So, So it's a bit of a challenge actually to find talent as well.
I can imagine. I can imagine it's also a lot of lot of people with interesting ideas, because this isn't something that's been explored necessarily, yes. You know?
Indeed.
Yeah, but when we spoke to other game development companies and studios, they said they often have people from abroad and they are doing something like working from home.
Oh yeah, and so much telecommuting that you know, having an actual location-based studio is not necessarily something you need to do anymore.
Yes, we do that as well. We have some developers who work from their homes, and we also have some remote teams cooperating with us. So it's part of our pipeline, and we've perfected this to quite a high level. Almost to a level where we have an actual quote, come to an office, unquote, approach virtually with some of these people.
Okay. And how are those Austrians involved that I got in touch with you over?
Austrians, you mean the people from Nordic?
Yes.
We have part of the production from Nordic. So production is being cooperated with Nordic. They also handle, for example, Martin, who is a producer on the project, along with myself, and also Reynard, who is also involved with production. Martin does some writing. They also help with the whole production approach. And I'm pretty sure there's going to be a lot of areas they will be involved in the actual production itself when they get into the rest of the production after the Kickstarter, which, as I just noticed, is about to hit the funding goal.
Yes, I saw that. I saw that. It's amazing. So it's a kind of a cooperation of two studios.
Yes, can say so. We are in cooperation with Nordic. We are primarily developers, so we are developing the actual product, while Nordic is the publishing / production, marketing, I guess, as well. Side of the whole cooperation so far. Now, when we get further down, this might change. You know, we might get some development as well from their end. This part is a bit unexplored, but yeah, it's a cooperation, and it's a good cooperation. We've been cooperating with Nordic not just on this, but with other projects as well in the past.
I saw that on your homepage. Yeah.
Yes,
I checked it out.
Yes, we've done work with them, and I think we have a good working relationship with them.
Yeah, it's interesting. So I wonder, as this is quite a game that quite has some history. How you got into that? I mean, they told me you are the CEO and underwater expert.
underwater expert is a bit of an exaggeration. but I would rather call myself underwater enthusiast than an expert. Because I don't actually have specific underwater stuff training except diving. So it's not like I have a master's degree in underwater, I don't know, oceanography or marine biology or something. But if I would not have been in video game development, maybe I would be there now. So I have a big interest in all that. And I also have extensive diving experience as well.
Me think that you're fairly an underwater expert.
Yeah.
I can't even swim, so
yeah.
I just sink.
That's also a way of swimming. That's the beginning of diving. For your knowledge, some of the divers I dive with don't actually know properly how to swim. So
really?
Okay,
it's not a key requirement, but it's a good thing to have.
Okay.
That's interesting. Anyway, I wonder how it moved from Germany to Serbia and how you got involved with the game.
That's a long story that goes back to, let me just tell you exactly the first one. was in March 21st, 2012. I think that's when, that's the date says on a file that I'm looking at. I have every single screenshot and VIP shot and thing from way of the communication. So basically we got into talks with Nordic about all the IPs they own. So, and they own the Aquanox. Because prior to that, we've been involved with them as well with other things. And we kind of made them an offer of, how about we make a new Aquanox game? And we put together a couple of, images, in engine in Unreal 3 back then, a couple of scenes, experimental scenes, paint overs, some ideas for the gameplay and so on. And we started talking, and that was, 3 years ago. And we kind of moved on, turned it all around a couple of times, and what to do, how to do. We've experimented with various gameplay prototyping, story ideas, how to do the reboot, what to reboot, what to rework, how. So it's been a process with a lot of twists and turns. But eventually we got to this point, and with quite a stable direction as of now, although still very, very early in the phase. So Kickstarter is also part of the approach of us learning what the community wants from a new Aquanox game. So it's a big part why we are doing the Kickstarter, because we want the community as involved as possible from the earliest possible point of production. And we have already learned a lot about how our ideas were and how the community sees our ideas, and how we are going to approach a lot of things.
And now, so, is this actually going to be a reboot, or will this be a continuation of what's already been put out there?
Well, so far the approach is to create a reboot, but it's not like a complete wipe of everything. So we use a lot of things from the old games in terms of lore, in terms of characters, in terms of places, in terms of factions, and so on and so forth. But they, some of them or most of them, will not be exactly as they were. They will have a different kind of integration, because this is kind of like an alternative timeline. So, and it plays much earlier to the time when humanity went under the ocean, because both Archimedean Dynasty and the Aquanox games play quite later, when humanity had a lot of time to evolve and create huge cities. We are much before that, so we focus on a more wild, wild west kind of approach, when it's quite raw and it's much more gritty, much more depressing. And the sense of survival is much closer than in those ultra high tech, later, very highly developed periods. So, player might actually meet younger versions of some well known characters.
That was my next question about, actually.
But I said might.
Might, yeah. Right.
But there, as I said, it's very important to put an accent on this, because as I said, we are doing the Kickstarter to find out what the people feel about our ideas, and we are a flexible developer, and Nordic is also flexible in this kind of manner, and we've been talking about these ideas. And we have, for example, on the weapons front, we have about 10 different kind of weapon system concepts at hand, off the top of my head, out of which we find one or two to be the better ones, and we are still trying to balance a good strategy with good combat that is not feeling like an underwater ego shooter, but also doesn't feel extremely slow. So it's still, and that kind of approach applies to a lot of things. We're not undecided on things, but it's more of an approach of seeing what people on the Kickstarter see. This is why we also have the voting on the stretch goals as well.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you
that's,
actually
that's
mentioned...
kind of cool too, because a lot of times when you reboot or you make a new version of something, the audience is always, you know, you can't make everybody happy all the time.
Yes.
And a lot of times people kind of, there's some vitriol from people as far as, you know, taking something that they loved as a kid or whatever and changing it around. And by doing the Kickstarter like that, you're actually letting people kind of influence the direction that you're taking it.
Yes.
And also what would interest me is how is your personal connection with the IP? Because you look like you are early 30s or something like me, or even younger. So I was a teenager 20 years ago when I played it. When we talked to a lot of other developers, a lot were like, I'm working at this place where I wanted to be like 20 years ago as a teenager. So did you also have this, you know, this passion for the game and always wanted to make the next episode of the game?
Well, there are about 5 games that I've played when I was young that I was like hyped to be involved with. One of them, or but kind of like the subject of them, because I was not exactly tied directly to Aquanox. I've played Subwar and Archimedean Dynasty, and I really liked the setting. I also played Wing Commander and played Freelancer, and I also loved those as well. So I kind of wanted to be involved with a project like this since quite a few years ago. Any other one is probably Baldur's Gate and maybe Gothic, but those are different kind of genres, but unrelated to this. But yeah, so and this way I kind of evolved into wanting to create a sim-like experience where you're piloting a ship. As the years moved by and when we kind of got involved with Nordic, it kind of cleared out that I want to go towards the underwater one, not the spacey one. Partially because I feel like there are a lot of space games right now. I don't mind. I love those kind of games. But I wanted to, I had this feeling that, okay, this is the time, this is a really good time to bring back Aquanox, because people kind of realize that there is this genre, because there was this huge gap when FPS and RPGs were dominating. And now we have this period where spacey sims are a trend, if I can say so. Yeah. And it's not just that, but also they are more accepted by people. They kind of, because it's something that's happening. Now, that is even better to bring back Aquanox, because obviously it's not exactly a space game. You don't play as a space game, but it's the closest one to compare it to, probably. Because you are piloting kind of like a ship. But to me, I think it's better, because it's you have the exploration aspect that you can't have in a space game, unless you take your spaceship into a meteor, but that's descent. So
well,
Yes, I remember that playing the Aquanox series games, and they were like, "Oh, I can't go there. The water pressure is too high or something." I said, "No, go a bit left. Now I can try forward," something like this.
Well,
I've never
played the Aquanox games, but I can imagine, you know, with space things like that kind of game, you can't, if you were to put any kind of exploration in, you have to really kind of ignore the facts of how the universe works, which is that there's lots of nothing, you know. And yes, if you did have a game, a space game, which was, you know, accurate to reality, it would just be months of nothing. So
yes, exactly.
You know, so it's almost the sort of thing where you could take this and make it a realistic sort of simulation of what that would be like, and not have to really suspend your disbelief too much, because you could hop in a submarine sort of thing and cruise around underwater and actually find things, you know, when if you went out in space, you would just go that way and keep going in that way and never ever find anything.
Indeed. Actually, Aquanox, Deep Descent, is in fact as much as scientifically as accurate as possible, and we are putting work into that when it comes to a lot of things, especially when it comes to water pressure, water density, sight range, and so on, sonars, the stuff that you can hear, as well as the whole sense of, well, you're basically helpless. You are in a tin can at the bottom of the ocean, and we are working a lot on making the player feel this. It's a big part of the game to feel that impact of the whole underwater setting.
Kind of isolation of all the pressure sitting on top of you.
Yes.
This sounds like a candidate for an arcade game where you sit inside.
an arcade game.
Yeah, well, that's the sort of thing I could. Yeah, that would probably translate well into like an enclosed thing in your.
Yeah.
Oh.
But that's, you know, that's also cool, because it's another big thing with a lot of flight games. You know, it's a simulator, they say, but it doesn't really take into effect or into account a lot of things that are, you know, wind and air pressures and all that stuff. That it, basically, it's the same sort of concept as underwater, just a lot less dense. You know, and it's the sort of thing that always annoyed me, because I always had this fixation with planes and things, and I play these games, and it's like, this isn't how it really works. This isn't what happens in real life.
Yeah. We actually have a prototype system right now. Not really visible in our Kickstarter videos and so on, because we don't really put too much emphasis on explaining those parts. Mm-hmm. But we have kind of like a water density kind of system in place that tracks a couple of things like water salinity, your depth, water temperature, the shape of your ship, and actually the speed that you're traveling at. So,
right.
And if you suddenly decide to turn, all these factors are being checked, and a lot of interesting things can happen. And this impacts torpedoes, different kind of upgrades to your ship, and so on. So, it's giving you the feel that you are underwater, and it's one of my gripes with the Aquanox games of prior, that they were good for what they've done, heads down. I loved them, all of them. Some aspects more, some aspects less. But it's one thing that we are upgrading or working on and experimenting with to make the ships feel more underwater-y. New expressions.
Yes, yeah. But you could also make an arcade mode for people who would just want to shoot, you know, like an arcade in a simulation mode or something.
Yes.
Well, there will probably be an easy and regular and expert mode to it. And the easy will be, you know.
Yes. Far from we. Please don't misunderstand. We are not trying to make a game that will make people
learn
hate the game
skills.
And go insane. But it really adds to the feeling of being underwater, because that's big part unique to this game. We don't want our game to feel that you are in space in any way. So, and we are definitely looking at ways to make some arcadey possibilities, but not in the main game. Maybe some training modes or some multiplayer modes, you know, some modifications, multiplayer game mode modifications where it's more ego shootery or more realistic and so on. But definitely difficulty can also play a big role. That's a good approach as well to that. For example, they're certainly going to have a difficulty set for your friendly fire or bumping into stuff, because if you would bump into something underwater in the old games, I think none of them actually had, if you bumped into ships, you got some damage, but not if you bumped into cliffs. But probably you would have a serious problem if you would bump in. So in a higher difficulty setting, you would have trouble bumping into a cliff. Or the bumping gear. I think I spoke about the bumping gear on the stream where I mentioned our ideas to make weaponized ship armors that you can use to ram other ships, which I think could be fun. I would enjoy playing that.
Mario Kart underwater or something.
Demolition Derby is underwater.
Yeah, or something like that, yeah. Oh yeah, Demolition Derby. Destruction Derby was it called on the...
I should write that up.
Yeah, Destruction Derby was it called on the PlayStation, one of the biggest hits.
Yeah.
21 years ago. Oh my god. Destruction Derby.
write this down, Joerg. We're going to make millions.
Destruction Derby underwater. So if you have any ambition to make a racing game underwater, get us under contract. We will make the best underwater racing game. I don't think this was even done yet so far. Nobody
underwater
had that.
Underwater racing? Yeah. I think someone's done another underwater racing game. I just don't think that it's been
famous.
I don't think it was that successful yet.
Okay. Mm.
No one stops players in, or no one will stop players in Aquanox Deep Descent to actually race each other in multiplayer. Mm.
But I guess the main focus will be to go from waypoint to waypoint.
I don't know.
Well, there's a role-playing aspect to it in which you're not just flying around doing stuff or shooting things. There's a plot going on, and there's I didn't grow up with the series. Well, I mean, the series was around when I grew up, but I didn't play it, so I don't know the specifics of it. But how are you approaching the role-playing aspects of this?
Prior games were entirely mission-based, so you got a mission on your base or the harvester ship, and then you go to the map and you get plopped out at the mission, you finish the mission, and you pop back to the ship or station. So that's how they did it. Now, what we are doing is we are letting the player to explore the world on his own. Now we will have zones that will be divided up, and you unlock these zones as you progress in the main story. And we have a lot of ideas on how to fill up the world with content, be that combat, exploration, mining stuff like gathering from hydrothermal vents, or different kind of ore stuff, enjoying just the scenery, like exploring, finding interesting places, trading or escorting missions, and things like that. We don't exactly plan, or we are not exactly planning into going into a detailed direct trading approach, like you being the trader. because we're looking at focusing on smaller ships, but there will be large trader ships that you can kind of like rent, and you fill up these ships with cargo and you set the course, or that's the idea, set the course of the ship, and it goes on to carry the cargo to that space, to that next base, and you follow along with your fighter or scout and you protect it. So it's kind of like you being the trader, but you get to keep your fighting as well. It's kind of like a mix of the two. You can still trade with your smaller ships. Some of the smaller ships will have quite a large cargo space if you want, and you can do a faster route that way. Then we also are looking at character story progression. Characters will have their own interest. You're going to be actually playing with four characters, so it's not like one main guy, but four characters, each with their own goals and ideas and personalities. And when on bases, you will be able to, or bases or stations or large ships where you can actually dock, you will be able to switch your pilot, so to say pilot, let's call them pilots, who's your actual pilot. And depending on the pilot you are using out of the four, you get various benefits, like some of the four will be better at exploration aspect, other will be better at combat. Each of them going to be have their own kind of like a passive impact on gameplay.
So you're not really officially a bounty hunter anymore, because I think in the first part you were officially a bounty hunter. This is how you started.
Yes, you were Deadeye Flint in Aquanox 1 and Archimedean Dynasty. No specifics on what you are at this point, but you will be four characters, as Martin likes to say. Okay. You're going to be a Ninja Turtles or A-Team kind of approach.
Okay, you don't want to spoil the surprise too much, of course.
Well, yeah, but it's not just that. It's also that we have different ideas for the different characters out of all the four. Each of them, maybe one of them can be a bounty hunter, maybe. Maybe they will have plots against each other. Also, when you are playing in co-op, just not to forget that the four characters are divided up into four players. So you get to play one of them. This depends on who wants to play which one. And this way, when you play co-op, the story can progress the exact same way as playing in single player.
So there is a multiplayer for up to four people.
Yes, co-op multiplayer, as well as other kind of classical, so to say, game modes, like, you know, the dogfights and an underwatery approach to capture the flag, which we will talk more about probably in the future. But yeah, that these kind of, you know, I mean, dogfights, like Team Deathmatch and Deathmatch kind of idea, I mean, that's a given for a game like this. It would be crazy not to be able to go online and just shoot someone.
Well, I did that like 14 years ago in Aquanox. I was like, oh my god, this is amazing. I can actually shoot my classmates that I, you know. And then the next morning when you go back to the your education place, you were like, I killed you yesterday, like twice, you know. So I totally remember that, and I was still living with my parents, and my mom asked me, what are you doing? I said, I'm just shooting down my classmate, you know.
Yeah.
And she was like, she didn't understand the word, but this Aquanox thing was one of my first online gaming experience thing, and this was totally awesome.
Cool.
Yeah. I hope I'm not mistaken, but they had multiplayer in
Aquanox 1, that
was definitely it.
When was Aquanox 1?
Well,
Aquanox was in 2001.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, like I said.
That's 14
years ago.
That's pretty early for multiplayer like that, wasn't it? That didn't catch on until I thought more recently.
Many people in Germany didn't have ADSL line even at that time, you know.
Right.
It started like one year earlier, and I still played it with modem and it worked. Oh my god.
Wow.
Yeah. So yeah. This is amazing, you know. Yeah, and nowadays you have like ADSL and cable like 50 megabits per second or something, yeah.
So it's been a long way.
Yeah, so hope you are having a good multiplayer, because I remember when I was playing Outrun Coast to Coast like in 2006, their multiplayer mode was horrible. It was always crashing and delayed and stuff. And that's especially hard for a racing game. I was like, how can you mess up such a multiplayer thing? I don't know.
Well, when it's released, we'll have to test it out, and I'll blow you up a few times.
I mean, nowadays you have different problems. I mean, personally, I'm talking to a lot of people from Africa, which 3G, so that's also not easy. And I also
my big problem is that I'm using a Mac. Will there be a Mac version?
You gotta
ask everybody that. Will there be a Mac version?
There will be, hopefully, a Linux and Mac version, as we have written on our frequently asked question for our Kickstarter. It's hard to confirm, as we are very early in production, but Nordic is well known for supporting Linux as well as, I think, Mac. I'm not very exactly involved with the Mac side. I'm more involved with the Linux side. And for my whole time of being as a video game developer, so to say, actively, from 2010, that's when we officially formed Digital Era, I've been very much keen on pushing Linux for gaming.
Even Steam supports it nowadays, so.
Yes, it does. Yeah. It does. It's been back then when I started telling people that, come on guys, we need games on Linux, everyone was like, you are out of your mind. And everyone, when I was pitching some games towards different kind of places, and I had a base criteria that the game must come to Linux, and I got a lot of pitches refused because of actually that. So
I can get behind that too, because I'm not I have a Mac, but at work and everywhere else, I always push Linux, particularly Ubuntu is the one I usually go to, because with family members that don't know anything about computers, it's easy. I mean, that's pretty much as easy as you can get. You know, there's your email there, push a button, whatever. But the big thing everyone always says to me about that is like, well, where are the games?
Yes.
It's like, well, I don't know. You know, there are none. But you would think that it being a platform that really, it used to be complicated. It used to be the sort of thing that you didn't want to mess with because you had to learn commands and this and that. But it has come to the point now where it's just, it's easier than Windows to run the stuff.
Yes.
And
it's a good thing, because now games are actually coming to Linux a lot more. So I really hope we will be able to resolve all technicalities when it comes to Linux. So we are working on Unreal 4. Unreal 4 has support for these platforms up to some level, obviously. It all depends on, like, for example, different kind of third-party plugins we might use, for example, or also maybe some of the features are tricky to run properly on some of the platforms. So it's not exactly not exactly easy confirm, like, yes, we will have Linux. I don't like promising things that I'm not 100% sure I can upkeep. So, but my hopes are high that we will do a Linux and Mac version as well. Hopefully everything will go well to make it happen. But we will probably confirm that during development at some point. We'll make a big update on that.
Okay.
It's interesting because this is a trend that I especially noticed since there's Kickstarter, that a lot of projects on Kickstarter are now Linux and Mac compatible, or even on the mobile platforms. And back then, when I started being a gamer 20 years ago, and you go to the store, or even 10 years ago, it was just Windows. And nowadays, nowadays you have Kickstarter, and you can involve gamers in the development process. And now they finally find out, hey, we have enough Mac users, so why not doing that as well? And
Well, it's gotten to the point where things are, like you said, it used to be you go to the store and then you'd have sections. Like there's your Commodore section, there's your Atari, there's your Windows or DOS or whatever, there's your the tiny little Mac booth over there, because nothing ever was made for that. And now it's like you barely go to the store to pick up an actual box of software anymore. And if you do, it's just like you know you go to a website and you download it and it's what you need.
This is why I always buy boxed versions anyway, because I'm a collector. I want boxes.
Yeah, because you're a dork.
Yeah, well, I'm a collector. That's the thing.
I like boxed versions as well, actually. Mm. But I usually kind of go towards boxed versions of games I'm really fond of.
Right.
I'm not really into getting every box. But there are games that I am really looking forward to or I really enjoy. Like, there are games that I own digitally, and later on I purchase the boxed one just so I can have it with me. Like,
Little
box.
So I hope you take special care about the one I pledged in your Kickstarter.
Which one did you pledge?
The one that was like 110 or something.
$110. That's
$10.
The shiny metal box.
Exactly. Yes.
Oh boy.
Is that the one with the manta ray tags? Sorry, I don't know exactly all of them by heart.
It says. Let me see what we have here. It says a Kickstarter edition only available during the Kickstarter campaign. You received a box collector edition in an exclusive metal box. It includes soundtrack CD, making of DVD, Aquanox, Manta, Raytag. Yeah, that is what you meant, yeah.
Yes.
And exclusive in-game content.
Oh yes, that one as well.
And an epic fanfare will be played, and your name will be highlighted when you join a multiplayer game.
Oh, yes. Hey now.
Oh my god. NAFCOM is coming online. Oh Jesus. Yeah. Am I that important? Incredible.
Yes. Well, it's a bit of a thank you for the people who supported us through Kickstarter. That's the Kickstarter collectors one that you can only get on the Kickstarter. So no other place will be available to get those extras. Actually, I didn't check. Is the goal close or not? Is it?
Well, I mean, within 2 hours, you already made a very, very big progress. I was like, oh my god. Yeah, you are $1,000 short, actually.
$800 short right now.
How long is there?
8 days.
8 days left?
Yeah, and $800 left.
Oh.
Yeah.
We'll make that.
It's interesting. Yeah. It's the shortest Kickstarter I've ever seen or something. It's like a few weeks. You didn't go for long.
Yeah. We came to a decision to do a shorter one. We discussed what to do, what not to do, and I don't exactly recall all the details. We just went with, 24 days. We can do this.
It's interesting because I have read some press reactions prior to writing to you, and they said that they quoted you for saying that you are not really after the money. You are more about creating a community of interested players to give you feedback on the development.
That's a big part, as I said in the beginning of our chat here, that we are looking into getting as much feedback as possible.
Yeah,
so it doesn't end with this Kickstarter.
Yeah, I know.
It starts with this Kickstarter.
But you were quoted for saying that you are not really in the need of the money.
Our Kickstarter is basically, as it is described on our page, is that we discussed with Nordic Games and we created this Kickstarter together and see if we can reach our goal. And if we do, we will have the rest of the investment assistance from Nordic Games that we need for the remainder of the project if we reach the goal.
Ah, okay.
And we are in need of the money, but this is our goal to see if people want this game. I also, in the Kickstarter video, I think I mentioned this, that we want to see if people want a new Aquanox game. And we hope they do, because we would love to see a new Aquanox game. I would really love to see a new Aquanox game. And
I will feel like a teenager again.
I do. You're $10 closer now.
You've pledged.
Yes, yes.
Thank you.
Yeah, yeah. We are always doing live pledging stuff.
Yeah,
yeah. it's just something I asked because other games that I pledged, they had a much higher goal. So this is why I was wondering if it's really covering your costs.
It covers some of the costs, certainly, but not the whole. So the actual budget is much bigger. If you scroll down on the Kickstarter page, about 3/4 or so, or towards the end, where it is says, "Why are we on Kickstarter?" or something like that.
Yeah, I read that. Yeah.
Yeah, so that there you can, it has like a little breakdown of this whole situation. Basically, it says that we are gauging people's interest as well in some level, but also it's not just that. We really, really want to see what people have to say, and we want to create a community for Aquanox where people will be able to voice their opinion, give their two cents in terms of, you know, ideas, suggestions. There's been quite a lot of ideas on the forums that I've been reading and writing back to people. And so far, actually, I've seen some ideas that I really liked and ideas that might actually in some way be implemented, you know, like suggestions that people would like to have. And they make good point. You see, we kind of see this Kickstarter as a gauge to have, as they say, sometimes an artist needs an extra pair of eyes to judge his artwork. And sometimes this happens to game developers, and I'm very aware of this. You get so attached to your project that you think that's the best thing ever. And I'm aware of that, and it happens to everyone.
Oh yeah.
Even the best designers and the best developers, it can happen. So it's a big part of the Kickstarter that basically our community is our lighthouse, as Martin likes to say. To see, okay, well, that's a good idea, and well, that is not exactly a good idea. So what do we do? And then we discuss it. And the earlier we do this in the development, so we are doing it in early development now. We are in prototype phase, pre-alpha phase, kind of. This is why I can't really give you a playable something. I would love to give you a playable something, but we can't. We don't. It's about 85 gigabytes in size, and it's a lot of raw data. And
well, of course,
it's not really possible to just go, here you go. If we could build an installer, you know, and give you, it would be a lot better. But unfortunately, we can't.
But I guess at some point for the supporters, you will have a playable demo. I guess, in the future, someone.
Yes, definitely. Well, the ones that pledged for the alpha will have access to the alpha very soon.
Upgrade your pledge there, Joerg.
Well, the problem is that it was also mentioned in the comments. You don't allow alpha access in certain pledge levels, and unfortunately, mine is included.
So you'll have to pledge twice then.
Yeah, you can't. You can only pledge.
Check the updates. There's been an update.
There's been an update today or yesterday or something.
Just now, just for you.
Alpha access and original games for all Kickstarter edition backers have been added today.
Hey, lucky me. So, yeah.
So don't change your pledge.
No, I kept it. You deserve your $7 extra. It's fine.
Yeah.
It's fine.
And also, I think that, you know, with the Kickstarter, like you said on the page, it also helps to increase awareness because the game was popular in places like Germany, but elsewhere it's not as well known. So this is kind of, you know, with Kickstarter, everyone gets to see it and they featured it as it's a staff pick. So it's almost advertising in and of itself, in that it really
I can say so.
Yeah, it gets it out there more because it's not something that I would have even, it wouldn't have been on my radar had it not been something that was, you know, highlighted there, and with Joerg telling me about it.
Yeah, well, the thing is, interesting thing is it is a German game. And the German version was called Schleichfahrt, which I own. I don't own the English version. And here in Germany, you could also get the German version. And the English version was released half a year later. So the English version is actually a translation of the German original. So.
Oh, boy.
Yeah.
Yes, it was a German original.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Schleichfahrt,
yeah, you know, even hard to pronounce for foreigners, you know.
Yeah,
it's if you translate it, it comes down as slow speed or something. Slow speed driving.
Yeah,
slow speed driving.
Actually, it means literally slow as a snake. You know?
That sounds like the least entertaining game. Wow, slow driving. Let's get that.
I guess the English name attracted people that. But the Schleifart itself is an expression, though. A good example of how you cannot directly translate it. It's also an expression on German that they used for the submarines where they went into stealth mode, kind of.
Oh.
Yeah, there's the movie Das Boot. If you haven't seen it, you should definitely.
I have seen it.
Oh, you have? Okay.
I have.
You
I don't
should
remember,
watch
it
in German. If you don't know German, watch it in German with English subtitles. Subtitles, sorry. Because it's much, much better in German. Is there actually an English one? I think there is an English one.
Actually,
someone probably remade it.
Actually, when you look on the DVD on Amazon, it says German with English subtitles.
Yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
It is. Okay. I didn't know if there's an English one because I only watched it in German with English subtitles.
But so. According to your LinkedIn, you know German.
I can understand some German, but
I mean, Norbert.
Oh. I understand. I'm not fluent in German.
Okay.
I understand some German. My writing is horrible in German.
Okay.
But you could probably not sell me in
Germany. Yeah, it's interesting. Because your name could also be a very typical German name, you know, Norbert.
Yes, it is.
Yeah.
Norbert is, I think, a German name.
So, something like German relatives or something.
Yeah. Maybe.
Who knows? Yeah, interesting.
It was my destiny.
Yeah, you know. Yeah, it's so what's the next thing? Cutscenes. I mean, Schleichfahrt was very much known for its cutscenes. It was awesome. It was jaw-dropping. I was like, I didn't know my slow DOS PC can handle this, you know.
Yeah.
So how you go about that?
Cutscenes is a very, very experimental thing for us right now.
But you cannot drop that.
No, I didn't say we can't. We will drop cutscenes, but I would say we still need to find a good way to approach cutscenes. Aquanox Deep Descent obviously is a lot of different kind of content, and so cutscenes themselves, we are still looking into what's the best way of doing them. This goes into conversation stuff as well, like how you interact with characters, as well as how you enter and exit bases and that kind of stuff, big moments in the story, so on and so forth. So I'm sure that it will be a fun and great experience. It's just that giving a definite approach to cutscenes right now, when we are not even in alpha, it's again the same way as with Linux. If I would say something right now and it wouldn't be that, I would not like to promise that yes, we will do full CGI ultra hyper extra cutscenes, because we don't know if we will.
Probably still in storyboard mode.
One thing we do know is that we want multi-choice dialogue. That's our key.
Like Wing Commander.
Sorry?
Like Wing Commander, where you had multiple choice.
It's very important for us, because in Aquanox and Aquanox 2, for example, especially in Aquanox 2, when I would say conversations were decent and more interesting for me. Maybe some people would disagree. I don't know. You could not choose your replies. And in some way, that worked up to some level. It was okay. I don't say it was bad. But there were cases where I would have wanted to say something else. Mm-hmm. Or I would have won, even if the outcome would have been the same or similar, you know, having the choice to agree or disagree would have been good. And it's a big part of our storytelling that the player will be able to agree or disagree or say his opinion or be serious or be jokey or be an a really annoying person. I don't know. having these kind of multiple replies. Also very important is that you will be obviously playing the four characters. So, and each of them will have their own personality. And then having these multiple replies with four characters, it's going to be an interesting conversation to be done.
Yeah, so...
And I just realized that Schleisfart means silent running. So you can take that and paste that earlier on.
Is it?
Silent running is the English term for it. So.
It's the silent running for the submarine.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So that does sound much cooler than slow driving.
That's the direct translation.
Yeah.
But yeah, as with a lot of things, you can directly translate.
Yeah.
Language is such a flexible thing, you know.
Yeah. See, the difference is slow driving is when you just drive real slow, and silent running is when it's dark out and you turn your headlights off so no one sees you.
So you see, you even get some English lessons today. So.
Or German.
Or German.
Or both at the same time.
Yeah, okay. So totally, totally awesome, I have to admit, yeah. So, right. So that's really going to happen. And I wonder if you say that you can choose your answers, that's a candidate for multiple endings.
Oh, people just like multiple endings, don't they? I can't really speak too much about this kind of
things.
Right now.
Well, I mean, multiple endings or not multiple endings. I mean, there's ways to do it, and again, I mean, you're pretty early in the process, so it's tough to really, you know, nail down whether that'll happen. But I mean, I've seen games that have multiple endings that are, you know, you follow your own path, you end up with a different ending. And I've also seen games where you can follow your own path, but they all somehow work out to the same ending. So I mean, you know, I mean, it could be a good thing, but it's not something that I think would be a deal breaker to not have multiple endings.
I remember in Command & Conquer, I used to save the last mission and before it ends, and then I make a different move and I get a different ending, just so that I see all the endings.
Mm-hmm. Yes, yeah, people like that kind of approaches, but I'm not saying that we are not going to have multiple endings. I'm also not saying that we will. That heavily depends on a lot of things. Big part, because we are so early in development, we are actually curious to know what people have on this subject. And big part, we are curious to know what people in general have on our story and our reboot approach and so on. So we will definitely, after the Kickstarter campaign ends, and we will be analyzing all the comments and all the forum reactions, and I don't know how many comments I've read on forums, on Kickstarter, on YouTube comments, on Facebook comments, on Twitter tweets, comments on articles posted on other websites, and I have a huge list of these, and we will look at all of them. And we will also, maybe we can spark a discussion about, okay, people, what do you think about multiple endings? I'm sure people will be saying, yeah, but I'm also sure there will be some that might not like them.
For me, it's totally exciting, because I never thought I would actually talk to head of development, to a developer who is developing the successor of one of my favorite childhood games. I have to admit, this is totally crazy, you know, and
We are actually very, as Digital Arrow, and generally the Aquanox team, so both from Nordic side, we are very community centric, or I'm pushing to be as much as possible, and I'm also not the guy in the tie, so I like talking to people, and I'm quite active on the English forum, at least. I would love to be more active on the German forum, but unfortunately my knowledge of German is not allowing me that. So talking to yourself or anyone who is down to chatting, and in our streams as well, we're going to be doing another stream. I don't know if it's tomorrow or the day after, or maybe on Monday. Still need to fix that down and announce it, because it hasn't been yet. But we like talking to the community, and we are not the kind of type that pulls back from that kind of thing. Big part, because I think it's, as I said, having the extra people voice their kind of approach gives you the possibility to make a game that they will genuinely enjoy. And it's not exactly easy, not just easy, I wouldn't say it's actually completely possible without being community-centric. Obviously, there are various levels to that, but some developers are more, some are less.
One thing that would interest me is how about the long-term support of multiplayer? I mean, I like to play a lot of older games multiplayer, and my big problem is, because I'm a retro gamer by heart, my problem is that many of the games I like to play, the servers are shut down. And that's really a big problem, you know, like GameSpy went out of servers, now I can't play half of my PlayStation 2 games anymore, because they all relied on GameSpy, that is not no more or something. And then there are different approaches, like, for example, for Command & Conquer, Electronic Arts actually gave away the technique for hosting your own your own server, kind of. So if you try to access the multiplayer inside the game, you get forwarded to the new homepage of the multiplayer. So I wonder if you ever thought about that long time support of multiplayer and so on.
Well, that's a interesting question.
I never had the chance to ask any developer
We're in pre-alpha, and you're asking him whether it's still going to be working 25 years from now.
Well, I never got the chance to ask anybody that. So today's my day.
I'm fond of providing as long-term support as possible. I'm also was. For example, very saddened when, for example, the freelancer servers shut down, and I was very happy for some of the mods bringing back the multiplayer. So I would say we will do what we can to upkeep the servers. That's like an extremely far away thing to really delve into right now, but I think if we are to get to a point where we can't upkeep our servers, I don't see a reason why we would not allow people to host their own. So
many people don't allow that, and that makes me pretty sad, you know. Because just the game is old doesn't mean it's not worth playing multiplayer anymore, you know.
So, I can't say it's going to be like this. That's even a tougher question than asking multiple endings.
Yeah. Well, it's interesting because I'm asking you a question and you realize you had this experience yourself. So
yes, I'm aware of different kind of problems that are like this. People also ask a lot about modding and similar aspects as well as the whole multiplayer and how co-op will ruin the single player and all that kind of stuff. So I'm aware, and we are also aware of the multiplayer support, but that's also a big part that is very hard for me to answer, not just because it's me as a developer, it also, this is something that we really need to also cooperate with Nordic, sit down and discuss options and possibilities. But if it comes down to giving good support for multiplayer, I'm sure we will do as much as possible from our side to make it good. And I think that's important to support it as long as possible.
I mean, it doesn't stop here. You have other problems like a new version of Windows and you get a new PC and suddenly your game doesn't work anymore. And then you have two fractions. One game developer says, oh, no problem, we make a patch for it. And then there's this other fraction who says, no, you are on the loose end because we stopped supporting this game, you know. And there are some crazy game developer studios who actually still have a support section for the C64 games from 30 years ago. Where I think who is writing to them asking for game support of a 30 years old game. So you have different approaches of that.
Retro gamers.
Yeah.
But yeah, well, also Nordic is actually well known. If you've looked at their background, actually recently they did support, like they ported some games to Linux, some older games, and also they made like remasters to some older games and upping them and patching them for some more modern systems. So they are well known, and I think they do a great job with that. And I don't think we will have problems with Aquanox in regards to that kind of things.
Yeah, it's just interesting for me because in the past I have always been bumped into those kind of problems. And I was thinking, I can't believe this, that the developer is stepping back and saying, not my problem. You shouldn't have updated your computer, you know, or something like that, you know. So I'm really happy to hear that you have been faced by those you have been facing those issues yourself, and you're trying, you're open for ways of solutions. That's pretty good. Yeah.
It's always good to be open. It's
yeah. It's also if you are open, I guess it makes it easier for your next game development. When gamers know, okay, this company is really listening to our needs. Yeah.
Well, I hope people will realize that we wish to listen. And we have the will to listen, so.
Right.
Because then more people will actually come and tell us what they think. It's also a big part if it spreads out that we are up to feedback, and we want feedback, then yeah, we have a forum, but it's not exactly active yet. I'm sure after the Kickstarter though it will catch up a bit, or at least I hope. I mean, it's not just that I go there for the feedback, but also to just generally have a chat, like, I don't know, even if it's off topic.
Right. So where can people find out about this stuff? You know, what websites and whatnot should we go to check out?
We have a website, which is plain and simple, aquanox.com. And we have a blog there. We have been posting development updates there, and we will keep on posting development updates, be that video logs, in-engine stuff, or just blurbs, you know, development blurbs. We have a forum, gallery, and so on. And we are also on Facebook, which is Aquanox Deep Descent, or just Aquanox. Generally, if you type Aquanox in the search bar, you will find it. And the forums are embedded on the website itself, by the way, so it's easy to find them directly to the Aquanox forums. So we also have a YouTube channel, Twitter. I think we did a Twitter channel. Yeah, we started a Twitter channel now for Aquanox directly.
Yeah, I think I already follow or something.
Okay. We did a Twitter channel directly so that we can push out small updates there.
So you mentioned Twitch earlier. So what are your future plans to show in the real, live video podcast thingy? Because Twitch is quite famous nowadays for being platform number one for video game streaming, so.
Well, I don't know if we will focus on Twitch or maybe use the new YouTube thing that came out recently, but we definitely plan to do streams now and then. Right as of now, I don't have a fixed like streaming plan of this is what we're going to be streaming. This is a new idea we had that we wanted to start during the Kickstarter, but it might as well be that we will stream now. So right now we are working still on the prototype. We can't show too much from the in-game itself because it likes to crash and all that kind of funky stuff, but we might as well show some in-game stuff on our streams, talk about the game, or just, you know, play the old games like I did on a recent stream and just compare the old game with the new game in the making. So it's also a big part of us gathering comments and also answering questions. I like answering questions.
keep them coming. It's interesting. I think the new thing you refer to is YouTube gaming, because that is what they started recently.
Yes.
As a competitor for Twitch. Yeah. So, you mentioned earlier you played a couple of games that you liked. So, would you see yourself as a pro gamer or hardcore gamer or something? Or are you a casual gamer?
Considering that before I actually started working in a video game industry, I was also a hardcore modder. I was also a hardcore gamer, and I think I'm still quite an active gamer, and actually I played Dota 1 competitively a bit, not so much. It was just regional. Played some Counter-Strike as well, 1.6. Competitively up to also some level, but I wouldn't call myself a pro gamer. And I still play. I mean, I wouldn't say there is a day that goes by that I don't spend at least an hour playing a video game. But I think that is usually a lot more. But, you know, it depends on the amount of work, for example. Because if I spend, let's say, 12 hours here in the studio, and I spend 12 hours looking at in-game or game prototype stuff and also documentation on games or articles on games, and then I go home, usually if it's like that, then I don't spend more than an hour or two. Maybe okay. I tend to play some Dota 2 with friends, but that happens usually every day.
I see.
But I also like to play some old games. I have recently installed Gothic 2, actually, to play it again, which I love. Yeah, I think that's that. I also been planning to, with a friend I've been talking to do some Warcraft 3 maps, because we did those back in the day. And maybe if my time lets me, we're gonna just have fun with that. We'll see.
But I guess your focus changed now that you're a game developer.
Focus in which
way? I mean, if you play a game or something, you are probably thinking like, okay, I could include this in my next game. Oh no, I maybe this one, or no, not this type of game again. No, my next game will not be like that. You know, you always have a mind running with ideas what to do and what not to do.
Well, it's the same thing if you are a press person. You can't read an article the same way as you did before, or if you play basketball and you are in the basketball league, you can't watch basketball the same way you did before. But I think I have a good way of blocking out these kind of things.
Seriously?
Sometimes.
Okay.
Like, you know, I just don't really care. I just chill out, you know. And I think quite often I can do that. Not always. One thing I do know is that I became a bit more critical about games sometimes.
That is what
you know,
I mean.
I notice mistakes. I notice good things. No, so it's not just I find the bad things. I have a much bigger appreciation for video games, because I know exactly how hard it was to do that. So, like, some people, like, they find a small bug about something and they explode about it, but they don't realize that that small bug is probably a result of a much bigger thing that was very hard to make, and that small bug is just a minimal thing. And, you know, it's a tricky approach, but I think I managed to lock out most of these things.
In game development nowadays, beta testing is very important, especially since you have so many different hardware. And at the moment, if you look at the gaming press here in Germany, there are a lot of things like, oh, this is powered by Nvidia, and this is running better on 8880, you know, AMD graphic cards. But I guess in your case, this is not really an issue. You don't have any preferences, I guess.
I haven't seen any issues so far on the prototype when it comes to Nvidia or AMD cards. And I'm certain that we will make sure that it is optimized for both approaches. So it's part of our Kickstarter also to get beta people and alpha people. And we will certainly do extensive testing to avoid these kind of things. So.
Well, I already secured my spot.
In the alpha. Okay.
Great.
Great.
I'm sure we will be getting a lot of feedback.
Oh yeah, yeah. I'm a beta tester for a living, so.
Oh.
Yeah, actually that's, but not for video games, for medical software. So,
okay.
but still I find bugs pretty easy. And I tend to crash games and programs if there's any loophole that allows me to, you know. Yeah, so. Right. Thanks a lot for being so open. This is great. So I'm really looking forward to the final game.
Okay.
And yeah.
Okay, just what I wanted to thank you guys as well for having me talking to you guys. I'm happy that people are interested in finding out more about Aquanox, and this is exactly why we are big part, why we are on Kickstarter and why we are open. And I'm also thankful not just for you, but in general, everyone who has left us their comments and their pledges. So probably our Kickstarter will be mentioned in the video, and we are basically at our goal almost, but
yeah, you never know.
I'm really looking forward to working on Aquanox Deep Descent and making a game that is worth mentioning in the lineup of these games.
And hopefully it's successful enough for another part.
Okay.
Yeah.
I hope so. It depends if people, if the communication with the community demands and people want more games. Who knows?
Yeah. One up.
Indeed.
All right.
Okay,
so thanks, Norbert, for your time.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank
Bye.
You as well.
Right,
have a nice day. And
you too. Good evening.
Yep.
Yeah.
Bye-bye.
Hello, everybody. So, this was our interview with Norbert Varga from Aquanox Deep Descent, that very cool Kickstarter project that, as of now, has 5 days to go and already reached his funding goal and actually exceeded it. And I wanted to say thank you for watching this. I hope you enjoyed it. If you didn't watch it, you should watch the video version, because we have included a lot of cool video effects and stuff from the pre-alpha videos that were sent to us by Nordic Games in Austria. So thanks a lot, guys, for helping us. And so you should check out more. If you want to check out more from Aquanox, you can do that on the Kickstarter itself. So be sure to pledge and have your vote and your voice in it to get the game becoming awesome. And that is at Aquanox Deep Descent. If you look for that on Kickstarter.com, it should show up. And as you heard, Norbert is really, really looking forward to hear your comments, to hear your suggestions, and to talk and communicate with you, which you can do at the forums too. That is also linked from the homepage of nordicgames.at. They are in Austria, and if you want to watch and check out the development studio in Serbia, that's digital-hour.com. As of us, we have a homepage, themeworld.org, and after this recording here, I will finish all text for the next issue, 25 of the Disc magazine. And also we have a podcast, more episodes of it, at themeworld.org/podcast, and also video interviews, where we will also put wonderful video interviews with pioneers and VIP in the technology area. That will also come along with the new issue, so make sure to check it out at themeworld.org/interviews or youtube.themeworld.org. Make sure to leave a subscription and leave comments on the videos, and we will answer it, no problem. If you want to check us out, AJ has a blog at justwesterfell.com. I really like his writing style. He's awesome. So check out his blog posts and have a laugh. And I'm at NAFCOM EU, and I write about all that crap, you know, IT and stuff, and how to solve problems with the PC and international communication as well. And that's NAFCOM.EU. And also, you can check us out on Twitter, sceneworld_twitter.com. Well, at twitter.com. Scene_world. And also, well, make sure to watch and listen to the past episodes. So see you next time. If you want to write to AJ and me, write to podcast@sceneworld.org. And we will be lucky and pleasured to answer you. Thank you. Goodbye, people. See you.
Yep.